Good morning and welcome to Ask Dr. Doreen. We welcome Dr. Doreen Grandpichet. So thrilled to be back here with you. We've missed a couple of weeks with her, mostly because I was out. I think I'm allowed to say now. I wasn't allowed to say for so long, but we have a new member of our extended family. My niece, who I adore so much, and her daughter, who I adore so much, and her husband, who I also adore, they adopted a little girl from Colombia.
That's amazing.
I was on duty on call because families have to go over and stay for a long time. So I was with my grandniece and on standby to go to Colombia if need be. But we welcome this new fabulous member to our family. And so I was out for a while. And then when I came back, we missed you 1 week because you had to be other places.
That's right. So it's been a while,
but thrilled to be back here with you. For those of you who don't know Dr. Grandpichet, oh, I'm so proud to be able to introduce you to her. She's a true expert in the field of autism. She has been helping individuals on the autism spectrum for more than 30 years. She is really, I think, the preeminent expert at not only recognizing what an individual needs, but what our community needs, what direction we need to go in, and seeing all of us for the whole people that we are, and being able to see what parents need, what practitioners need. She's amazing. She's
Thank
a gift
so
to
much.
All of us.
And Thank you.
Thrilled that we get a period of time every week that she answers your questions. We do like to remind you at the start of the show, though, that there is no expert that can give individual specific advice in this format. There just isn't enough time. And you know, an expert, a true expert, wants to meet the individual before giving individual specific advice. But in this forum, you can write in, and what I like to say is take a tour of her brilliant mind. Ask her questions so that she can tell you a little bit about what she knows, which helps you to make decisions down the road and see what's next and what questions you might have next. So I don't want to belabor that too much, but welcome.
Thank you so much.
And
it's good to be here.
It's thrilled to have you here. I'm going to jump right in with a question that somebody emailed me. Hi, Shannon. Hope you are keeping well, and I am. The person wants to know, their son gets dental work completed. As you can imagine, his anxiety is through the roof. He had a general anesthetic last year for teeth extraction, which was a nightmare. It ended up that his son had to be held down and given anesthetic through a mask. More work is now needed. Today we visited the hospital and tried oral sedation medicine 2 times. You know more about how to say this.
Yeah.
Tablets to try and relax him. Liquid medication is a no-go for him. He was so anxious, and the sedation had no impact on him, even though it was a high dose. They want to try another sedation medication in a few weeks, but I'm worried that even mentioning the hospital again will send him into panic mode. No amount of preparation seems to help. He goes into full panic mode, especially when this procedure involves his major anxiety, going to sleep. Any advice you could give on how we can make this better and easier for him will be much appreciated. I think, I'm just realizing, I think this is the same mom that had written in about having the anxiety of going to sleep that you had talked to, because she said, sorry for getting in touch again so soon.
Right, possibly.
I think so.
Right. So, you know, I find that a lot of times I love that this mom wrote, no amount of preparation seems to help. I guarantee you, if you do what I ask you to do here, it'll help. It does require some time. So if you have, when is it? In a few weeks, perfect, you have some time. So what you have to do is just the shaping procedure. Sometimes what we do is we just think that we can either explain things to our kids and they'll get it, or we can just expose them to a situation that's highly fearful and they'll overcome it. The problem is that it just doesn't work. Our kids, they don't really understand like a typical child would, what, you know, that this is a small amount of pain, that you're going to be fine, don't worry. They go into full panic, and once you hit panic mode, forget it. Like, nothing, reason doesn't work anymore. So what you have to do is you really have to do this in a gradual phase with this child. So what I would do is I would find out exactly, first of all, let me ask a question. It would probably be easier if you, let's assume that you, I don't know if your child knows how to swallow pills, but you might actually want to work on teaching the child how to swallow pills and then go that route, because it's going to be very hard to kind of, you know, hold him down and all that sort of stuff. But whatever the procedure is that the doctor thinks needs to happen, the sedation procedure, you need to work your child up towards that procedure. Now, I'll explain what I mean. So what you do is you will, let's say tomorrow, get in the car, drive over to the hospital, and reward your child just for the drive, and that's it. Then the next day, you will drive over to the hospital and actually get out of the car and go to the front of the building, or go all the way into the elevator, to the point where your child does not have a negative reaction. You just want to push it a tiny bit further. So I would probably the next day go to the building and then give your child a major reinforcer. You have to identify the reinforcers. Identifying reinforcers is the key thing. If you don't have effective reinforcers, none of this is going to work. So identify something important to your child. Don't give that reinforcer to your child except for during this procedure. In other words, make sure your child doesn't have access to that reinforcer the rest of the time. If they do, satiation will occur. He won't be interested in it because he can access it some other time. So ideally, you want to pick his most powerful reinforcer. I don't care what it is. It could be music, computers, TV, food, a hug, whatever it is. So you want to get him to the door of the building. Then you give him, let's say if it's computers, you give him the iPad and say, good job, fantastic, whatever it is, or if it's a food item. The next day, you will basically go inside the building, and the whole time you're talking about how fun this is. Like, depending on his level of comprehension, you're like, we're going to go have fun. This is an awesome place. So now you get in the elevator, and you actually go to the floor where this dental work is supposed to happen. So you do that, you give him a reinforcer. You might have to do that one or two days. It depends on your child's reaction. If he's going along and he's having a great time, then you're good to keep adding. So the next day you go a little bit further, you work this out with the dentist, and so that you basically now get him to the point where he comes and says hi to the dentist or the people. This might cause him anxiety if he already knows them from the past. Regardless, you push a little bit and then you don't push further. You just get him to the point before the meltdown. Before the meltdown. That's what's really important. The whole experience has to remain positive. So it might take 2 days at any level or 3 days. It doesn't matter. Then you get to the point where you actually go, and then the dentist or the nurse or a technician who's going to be working with him gives him the reinforcer. And then you do that a couple of times so that he starts to associate that individual with some form of reward. And then you just keep pressing further and further and further. Now, it might seem easy enough up to this point. When you get to the, let's say, mask, obviously they're going to have to just practice putting the mask on. We've done this with injections, like, even. So, you know, we've had children sit in the chair,
Blood pressure cuff?
The tourniquet. Put the tourniquet on.
Oh, for the shot, I see.
Yes, for a shot. Like, take a sample, pretend syringe, get the injury, like we've done all the way to where the only thing we haven't done is the actual syringe.
Yeah.
So the actual needle. So you really are doing everything except the actual gas. And so that's what you're doing. And you reinforce every phase of the game. It takes a little time, but what you're doing is you're conditioning the experience to a pleasant reinforcer. You're connecting those two things. And it's very, very important that you do it enough times that the whole process becomes positive. When my children were young, I would always, whenever we went to see the pediatrician for whatever reason, if it was a shot or an illness or whatever it was, I would always, right after the pediatrician's appointment, go downstairs where the pharmacy is and buy them a present. Always. Because it then helped them associate that entire experience with getting a gift, getting a toy. And that was very helpful because sometimes they just didn't want to go.
And some doctors do that. They have the lollipops. Absolutely. Or the, my pediatrician had a choice between a lollipop and a sticker.
Yes.
And Jem was all about the sticker.
Right.
Like, I get to pick the sticker. I get to pick a Scooby-Doo sticker.
Yeah, my kid's dentist, still to this day, which is funny because they go up to 18, but he has a chest of things you can choose from. And he would say, well, today was really hard, so you can pick 5 things.
Wow.
You know? My kids would go crazy over that when they were little. So yeah, that's always a really good process. But you know, not too many people do that, so you need to do that yourself.
Yeah.
Now, the other thing I want to say, and I don't know where you live, but there are some dentists who specialize in autism. I mean, a very, very good one is, I know some here in the Valley, in Los Angeles area, who are amazing. One of them is a former parent of a child with autism, and just incredible dentist, and has her whole practice set up in a sensory friendly way in order to make sure our kids are doing well.
Okay, I'm gonna have to get that
information. Yeah.
Yeah. But I wonder too, because the second part of this is about the child not. I'm assuming, mm-hmm. and I should never assume, but a lot of us, I'm gonna include myself in this, don't like the feeling of when we're not in control.
Losing control.
When we're like, I have friends that, you know, you say Xanax and they go, oh, Xanax, right? And I go, oh, Xanax.
Me
just,
too. I'm, you know, like you.
Oh, because it's like, I feel like when I've taken a Xanax, it's like bumping down a flight of stairs. Once I get down to the bottom, I don't care about anything, right?
Yeah.
But that feeling, oh, I avoid taking a Xanax.
Yeah, losing control, yeah.
So is there anything we can do to help our kiddos that don't like that?
Well, I mean, again, it's you know, you're trying to increase a behavior. So again, it's all about establishing reinforcers and connecting the reinforcers to the right time. I think that generally speaking, children, it's not about control for children, because children don't have control yet.
Right.
For adults, it becomes about that worry of losing control. It occurs after you are responsible.
So that's not what it is in the
kids.
No, that's not liking that weird feeling.
No, it's not that. It's about, I think it's just a fear of not knowing where they're going, like what's happening to them. You know how when you wake up and you don't know what happened?
Oh, yeah.
That's the fear. It's kind of like, where was I? What happened? Yeah. Where am I? That sort of thing. And I think it's simple enough if you just reinforce the child in the morning when they wake up and just make a big deal about the fact that you slept. That was awesome. Great sleeping. What dreams did you have?
Yeah.
Maybe talk about the dreams, laugh about the dreams, make the whole experience of sleep a fun, pleasant thing that we all have.
Okay.
And then when you do that, the fear goes away. I mean, for children, a lot of this is just fear. It's not even about the pain. It's just about fear. You know, my Charlie, as you know, my daughter had surgery and stuff. And now she says to me, you know, I need to have my wisdom teeth taken out. I think we should just do it, because right now I'm so brave. Because she had this fear. She's not. She's like, I'm like not afraid of anything anymore. Just get me the, you know.
So it's amazing. It's, very empowering for her.
Absolutely. That, I mean, because she had major surgery. Yeah. So it's like, you know, a shot now, which used to be a big deal a year ago, is nothing.
Amazing.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to take a short break, and then we're going to come back and answer a question about how to encourage conversational and socialization. Stick with us.
Hi, I'm Shannon Penrod, and we're at the ABCs and XYZs of Special Needs Conference. And this year, for the first time, they've got something really remarkable. It's the Entrepreneurial Boutique. These are all items that have been made and are being sold by individuals who have special needs. So we're going to do a little shopping and talk to some of these fabulous entrepreneurs. Come on.
My name is Molly Rarick, and I'm founder of Breeds Gift. We're a nonprofit that serves teens and adults with special needs, like Chase here. We were founded in 2013 and serve people in the Conejo Valley, Santa Barbara, and LA.
Our main objective is to give our participants the skills they need to gain a more independent life.
My name is Shelley Cox, and Lisa Zalagi and I are founders of Creative Steps, and create micro business enterprises. And the items that we're selling here today are all made by the clients who have passions about what they want to make, and then they get the profits from what they make after we've paid all of the other expenses.
We are here today because my goal is to be independent, and also I would like to share all my artwork and I would like to sell.
Thinking about his young age being a businessman, you know, it's amazing. I cannot be more proud.
Welcome back to Autism Live. We are here with Dr. Doreen Grandpichet, and she is answering your questions in real time, which is a real pleasure. We have questions coming in on Facebook, on YouTube, and on the live feature, but I want to take one that we had earlier this morning. How do you encourage conversational speech in an autistic teen, 17, who can speak but avoids it? Mm-hmm. My sister is very knowledgeable but keeps her words to a minimum because it's easier.
Right. So again, this is now we need to start actually becoming behavior analysts because we've listened to this show so many times. So here we go. What do we want to do here? We want to increase a behavior. What is the behavior we want to increase? It's conversational speech. Now, this is a great situation because we know that the individual already has some conversational speech. Let's be sure of that.
Okay.
Because having speech is different from having conversational speech. Okay?
Very.
So conversational speech involves a lot of different areas, which, you know, on skills, we break that down. I mean, it involves everything from turn-taking to knowing how to initiate a conversation, how to fix it when it's broken, how to pay attention to the other person's responses, how to give the other person equal time, how to converse with one person versus a group, how to stay on alternate topics. I mean, there's a million things in conversational speech. So first, I would make sure that the individual knows this, each of the individual parts of that. And if they do, then it's, what do we do when we want to increase a behavior?
We reinforce it.
We reinforce it. So what is the individual's reinforcers? Identify the reinforcers. It's not as simple as saying, like, so for for typically developing human beings, why do we converse? Why do we converse socially? Have you thought about that?
I would think it would be for lots of different reasons, but obviously sometimes it would be for attention.
So absolutely, sometimes. So if we take away not conversational speech, we would include things like to meet my needs.
Yeah.
Right? Those types of things. But conversational speech in particular, sometimes for attention.
I would think it would be, well, you said to get your needs, to get access to the things that you need, to get information.
Information, absolutely. And a lot of it is just the reinforcer we get that we call social.
Yeah.
That whole concept of social, which is a very kind of abstract, broad term, but we refer to ourselves as human beings as being social beings. Mm-hmm. What does that mean is that we, even, you know, let's say, some activity, I was very, very good at a particular activity, the likelihood that I would do it alone is much less than the likelihood I would do it with others, with a team of people. That's, it's a, be having, interacting, sharing, however you title it, but sharing with other people is just a natural reinforcer for most of us.
I was just going to say, it feels good
for some of us.
Because I'm always trying to get my son to talk to me about a wide variety of things, because to me, that's the biggest joy in the world.
Absolutely.
For him, it's a little bit of work.
It's a little bit of work and it's not as reinforcing, right?
Yeah.
So for me, it's the same. Like with my husband and I, he's a very, very social being and he's grown up with five extremely talkative sisters. So he's a very talkative and social person. And I get really, really tired during the day because I have so many people talking to me. When I go home, sometimes I just want to not talk to anyone. And I have my husband and my kids and everybody's talking to me still. And it's not necessarily reinforcing. Sometimes it's punitive even for me.
Yeah.
So we have to realize that conversational speech has different value on its own. Some people like it, others don't, okay? So for those of us, as you think about us, for those of us who are very intrinsic and not extrinsic human beings, not social outgoing people, but rather people who would rather be more in our heads or more isolated or more, what makes conversational speech increase or reinforcing is the content. And even if you end up using a sort of synthetic reinforcer, it does not, like, you know, there are certain reinforcers that are natural to the situation, this does not have to be that. So you could select what is a very meaningful, let's say, reinforcer to your sister, whatever it is, and actually give that item contingent on having a certain length of conversation. Make it very obvious. Start with that and say, I need you to converse with me. I need you to have a conversation with me. Can you do that? And sit down and say, okay, well, we talked for, 10 seconds. The minute we get to 60 seconds, I'm going to take you out and get you ice cream, take you out and go watch a movie, whatever it is that's reinforcing to the individual. But again, I mean, not just this. Any particular behavior that you want to increase, pair it with a reinforcer. Don't forget, that's all ABA does, it actually administers a reinforcer to any segment of a behavior that you want to increase. That's all you're doing. You're just reinforcing the increase of a particular behavior.
People get we all get in our heads thinking, oh, well, if it's something that's outside, that, we're creating this weird circumstance, and yet everything in the world is that way.
Absolutely, and it doesn't even matter because you're just starting that way. I mean, you can always shape it to natural behavior. In fact, let's just talk about that for a minute. When you are, we have to come to the realization that over time we establish reinforcers that way. So let's just talk about this. So for me, for instance, right now, because I'm a horrible golfer, golfing is not at all a reinforcer. In fact, it is a pure punisher because, like, when I go out there, it's embarrassing in front of other people. It's very frustrating. You sometimes hit the ground and it hurts. It's irritating because it takes 4 hours of tension. You're the worst person. It's a lot of punishment associated with it. For my husband, because he's incredible at golf, it is a pure reinforcer. In other words, he would do golf rather than do anything else, right? So that's his primary, almost the primary for him. Now, how did that come to be, right? How, in the beginning, golf would have been equal to both of us,
right?
It was a neutral stimulus to both of us. It became reinforcing to him because over the course of his life, it was gradually, initially, it was also punishing for him because it was paired with punitive circumstances for both of us. Mm-hmm. He just kept at it. So over the course of time, the experience of golf became associated with positives.
Yeah.
Because he started winning. He started doing better. He started getting trophies. He started improving. That feeling of doing better, of succeeding, became paired with golf.
Yeah.
Golf then took on the secondary properties of a reinforcer. So don't think that most things, conversation being the same thing, most things start out as being completely neutral stimuli. They become positive or negative based on what we pair with them.
Yeah.
That's what's really important. So ultimately, if you pair some sort of synthetic reinforcer with conversation with your sister, over time, conversation itself will take on the positive properties of a reinforcer.
Yeah. I just wanted to make that point. We are already doing it, but just be conscious about how you do it. And it's a way that you can be more successful at most things,
right, which
is a really cool thing. Okay, I want to move to a question. And I just want to say that this parent is so on it because not only did she send me this question before, so I have it on our sheet here, but she resent it again this morning.
Awesome.
So we were going to address it, but thank you for sending it again. Hi, Shannon. Thank you so much for this wonderful show and for such a wonderful segment with Dr. Doreen. Hi, Doreen. Mm-hmm. I'm a mom of a 13-year-old boy on the spectrum, and we are in India. My son is recently showing some anxiety when eating food, especially just before finishing his meal. It is as if he is worried about reducing the amount of food in his plate. Another issue is that he does not look anywhere else when eating and is fully focused on his plate and sometimes tries to gobble some food. Usually after a meal, he does not have any difficult tasks to do. So I don't know why he gets tensed up. Any advice would be greatly appreciated. Please read this as I really need your valuable advice. I'm a user of skills and I'm wondering if I could have helped to target this behavior issue from CARD. And she had sent other information. Did you find the question?
Yeah.
Because there was something about tapping the fork as well.
Right. And in this one, it says that my son is showing anxiety when eating food. It is as if he's worried whether he could get more servings or not. He taps his spoon on the table or on his arm and says, all done, while actually he needs more. It's as if he finds it calming to hear from me or my mom, no, you're not all done, you can eat more. So, and I was reading this while you were reading that, so I was trying to just envision what the issue is. And tell me what you think, Shannon, but I think what I'm getting is that the child experiences some anxiety over his food running out.
That's what it's sounding like to me, that yes.
Yeah. Okay. So if we are, and then like I have a lot of questions, so maybe mom can respond to this. So, you know, when you give him, when he eats his food, let's forget about the behavior for a moment, but when he eats, when he finishes his whole plate, does he seem satisfied or is he hungry? Because that is, I think, the key thing. If he's satisfied, then we can deal with this issue if he's in a different way behaviorally. If he's not satisfied, then we need to talk about the amount of food so that, you know, maybe his anxiety, I'm trying to determine where his anxiety began. Is it simply because, you know, we might get anxious about something if we feel like we're not getting enough of it, like I need more, or is it just something that has been associated with some other behavior? I don't know. So I kind of need to know that first. And then also, what would happen if you did not say, no, you're not all done, you can eat more? Like, what happens? Will he just continue to say all done, and will he stop? Have you ever tried putting it just on extinction? Because I think what you're trying to ask me is, how do I get rid of, I think you're asking me how to get rid of him saying all done.
She sent some clarification.
Wonderful.
She says, yes, anxiety about food running out.
Okay.
It is not clear if he is satisfied or not.
Okay. So let's work on that one first. Like, let's make sure that you have a healthy dose of food. I don't know his weight. I don't know his height. I don't know much about that, but you can look that up medically. There's a certain amount of calories that an individual of different ages and heights and weights should be taking in. Let's just make sure he's receiving the appropriate amount of calories, first of all. Mm-hmm. If you're sure about that, you could do two things. One thing I would start doing right away is I would put it on extinction. Him saying all done, I would ignore. Completely ignore it. Let's see what happens. What'll happen is it'll increase first, and then it'll dissipate and go away, and he'll just continue to eat his food. Don't interact with him. Don't give him things like, no, you're not all done, you can eat more. Don't say that sort of stuff, because it could be just attention seeking. So if ideally what'll happen is he'll just say, all done, but he'll keep eating. And at the end of his meal, you'll say, that was very good, good job, great, give him a reinforcer and you're done. That's what I would suggest you try first. Now, an alternative to this is that you simply
I'm just going to interrupt because she sent more. She said he is a healthy weight, and she says, I haven't tried offering food when he says all done.
I wouldn't want to, I don't think you should offer food. You're just putting a plate in front of him, and I assume as he's eating, he's saying, all done, and you guys are calming him down by saying, no, you're not all done, you can eat more. I would just make sure that the plate of food in front of him is an adequate amount, and then I would ignore him from saying, when he says all done, because I think that he can easily calm down from it, eat his food. That is one way to go about this. Another way to go about this is to actually give his meal to him in two servings, which means here's the serving dish for him, not the family serving dish, but a serving dish for him, and here's his plate. And you can put half of it on his plate, allow him to eat, and when he starts panicking, you can just point to the serving dish and teach him how to serve the rest for himself. That's another way to go about doing it. But this all really has to do more with kind of where did the behavior start. I'm kind of getting into telling you too much without knowing the function. So I'm a little concerned about that. But to begin with, I would just try to ignore the all done and see how he responds.
And this is a skills mom. And one of the questions that she asked, is there a way that CARD can help me with this? And there absolutely is, because
Definitely.
There's CARD telehealth.
There's CARD telehealth for sure. You can contact our telehealth. You can just go through our admissions if you like and request telehealth services. And a supervisor will get on the phone and advise you. Another thing is, have you done the CIFA on skills, which is the indirect functional analysis, the assessment, that will help you identify the function of this behavior a little bit better.
Okay. And then let me know if you need more help connecting to that. But if you go to centerforautism.com, there's an 800 number there. You can call that. There is also a portal now that I think you can connect
to. Yeah, the parent portal, that's right.
That you basically, it's an email, which would be easier if you're in India than calling the 800 number. You can connect to that. You put in your information. This is all new in the last week, which
that's
is why
right.
we haven't talked about it before. So anybody wanting to connect with CARD, it basically takes your initial information and then is able to send that to somebody so that they can get back in touch with you via the information you give them.
Absolutely. And since you are a skills user, you also have that avenue. You can also contact skills, and they also have people who can assist you through various things on the phone. They can refer you to a supervisor as well.
Yes. You would not be the first person in India who's used that benefit. So that would be, but let us know how things go and if you need more support in terms of that. We're going to take a break and then we're going to be back with more Ask Dr. Doreen after these messages. Welcome back to Autism Live and to Ask Dr. Doreen. We're here with Dr. Doreen Grampiche. She's answering your questions in real time. We're thrilled to have her here. I'm really excited to hear your answer to this because I relate very much to this question. Dr. Doreen and Shannon, hello. My middle schooler has ADD and autism. He's in a regular middle school and doing pretty good, but seems to be really disorganized mm-hmm. and misses assignments when he forgets to write them down. Can you recommend any executive function resources I can use to help support him? I used to teach junior high. I have a junior higher, and I appreciate with the whole idea of autism and ADD and ADHD how much more difficult it could be. But I can tell you, having taught seventh and eighth grade, every single mm-hmm. seventh and eighth grade student could use executive function support
Definitely.
And help.
Definitely. It's funny that you say that because we actually developed this whole section of our curriculum because of this. We were watching our younger kids get to middle school, and the format changes in middle school, you know, where in elementary, you pretty much are in your classroom and teacher tells you what to do and you're dealing with one teacher and it's, you know, it's pretty organized for you. when you hit middle school, now you're dealing with possibly going from classroom to classroom, running to your locker in between, people giving you homework that isn't due tomorrow, it's due next Tuesday or whatever it is, and just, you know, procrastination, all this sort of stuff starts to creep up. So in our EF functioning, I think it's in our executive functioning, I'm pretty sure it is, it's planning. It's in the planning section, and it's called, I think it's called task planning in skills. There's a whole series of lessons on this subject, but there's also very, very useful forms. We've produced forms that, first of all, you know, one thing you have to teach your child at the very beginning is to do two things, which is when the homework is assigned, they need to write the homework down. That's a very, very important thing. And if they can't do that, then you just need to remind them or have the teacher remind them or get them a watchminder that reminds them or a buzzer at the end of the class or on their phone or whatever it is, something that says, did you write down your homework? You know, I mean, these days it's simple enough to set an alarm for a kid's phone and the alarm says, write down your homework before class, before leaving the class. But where you write it down is important too. So you can write, you have to teach the child to write it down on today's date when it was assigned, and then also on the date that it's due. And so when it's written down in those places, then the next behavior children have to learn is to always, every night when they're doing homework, to look forward 2 days. So we're looking at what's due tomorrow and the next day, and we're working a set number of hours, so like 2 hours a night on homework, regardless of if there's nothing due tomorrow, you still do the homework for the next day. If you still have nothing there, you do it for the next day. You work 2 hours every night. And the forms that are in that task planning section are very helpful because they teach you task planning as a whole. There's a lot of these forms, kind of like calendar forms and forms to help you organize yourself for the child, not for the teacher, but for the child. But there's also forms that help you just plan other things. Like for instance, you know, you're going on a trip. Like you have to look at the weather, you have to pull out a suitcase that's the appropriate size, how many days, what types of clothing, you know, how do you put it together, all that sort of stuff. And you do it two or three times and the child learns how to plan a task. That's what this issue is. And I would recommend you look under skills in the task planning section, which is under executive functions.
And I just want to say too that more and more junior high schools are getting on board and realizing we have not yet gotten to the point, but we're going to start addressing this. You know, we have a new segment here that's called Autism in the Classroom, and we're going to start talking about tools for teachers, and that's one of the things we'll take on is how they can be teaching executive functions mm-hmm. and how they can set up their classroom in a way that it supports it. But more and more technology things are coming out. Right now, we have something at my son's school that a lot of schools have that's a portal that allows me to see when he misses something so I can catch it before grade time.
Right.
And we also this year had a set of team teachers who subscribed to something that I think it's called Remind. Mm-hmm. And it's an app that the teachers remind. So I get a text, my husband gets a text, my son gets a text every single day that tells us what all the homework is and all
fabulous.
The classes. So he's supposed to write it down, but I have a way to check it. Because if he doesn't write it down, I'm up, you know what, creek without a paddle.
Right.
You know,
I'm
going to read minds and know what the homework was.
Right.
So before we tried taking a picture of it with his phone.
Does he carry a phone?
Yes.
Yeah. Can you set an alarm on his phone, which is like the end of the class?
They won't allow the phones to make any noises.
Can you put it on vibrate?
I could. He's pretty good now about, now that it isn't attached to it, he's good about writing it down. But the fact that I have a way to check it
makes a huge difference. Absolutely.
Because now it's rewarding to him to write it down.
Definitely.
Whereas before, that was the moment where we would stand and I'd be like, well, what does that mean?
Yeah.
You know, you wrote this down and it's exactly what the teacher wrote down, but now I'm asking, and he didn't feel like there was any kind of a reward for it.
Sure.
Now that piece has been taken out of it and I have
a very good way,
it has helped that. So be on your teachers too in
to
your
get
junior
the
high.
List. Absolutely.
To have a way of communicating that
absolutely.
Stuff.
Absolutely, very important.
But I love the idea of almost like what they teach people in sales about, you know, so you talk to them on this day, what's the day that you have to talk to them again?
I mean, that was the big problem. It was kind of like for kids being able to track, like, something is not due tomorrow.
Right.
I mean, most of the time, it's not just, writing it down is one issue, understanding the instructions, as you say, is one issue. But then procrastination, so that people don't, the middle schoolers will tend to not do it until the last minute. And then it's such a huge pile that they panic and do poorly. And that is, I think, it's just a task. I think it's something that teaches you lifelong. You know, I look at my kids, my own kids, and Nikki was always very, very organized and really good at this.
Yeah.
And so she excels in everything because she's so organized and she keeps track of stuff like that. And I remember my dad also telling me this, and I see that, you know, being able to organize things is a huge skill. I mean, if you look at all the people around me, like, yes, you know, Dennis and Sarah and Kathy, they're all extremely organized people.
They are geniuses.
Right.
They scare me.
They do. So, I mean, I think that's a very good life skill.
It absolutely is. There's a lot of women now. Have you heard of the bullet journals?
No.
So I've started keeping a bullet journal this year, and it's frightening how much more I'm getting done. And it reminded me, a lot of people are not responding well to things like Outlook because they're not technology people. And so for a lot of us of a certain age, there's this thing called a bullet journal. I'll have to bring it in at some point and show. But it helps me to track an event and to be able to move it to the next event. It's really reinforcing
cool.
to me.
Yeah.
And it's helping me to get stuff done that before I
just
lost track of.
Yeah.
So I'm not there yet. Let's not make any statements about that. But anyway, I want to really quickly, and then I want to take a short break again. Our India mom wrote and said, thanks a lot. I strained hard, but I still didn't get what the new service was that you just shared. Can you please share it in writing? So Samantha, if you can put up on the screen, the place where I want you to go to is www.centerforautism.com. So there it is right there, centerforautism.com. When you get there, there's an 800 number, but you should also have a link there that says I think it's new information or new patient portal, P-O-R-T-A-L. That would be the thing that you would click on that would put in your information, and then they can get back to you, okay? But you'll find that on the page centerforautism.com. All right, short break, and then we're gonna come back with one more question. Stick with us.
What is autism?
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 I've been asking myself that for a very, very long time.
Let me think about that one.
Trying to,
Jeez, let me think. Oh man, that's a tough one. Yes.
Autism is a neurological disorder that affects many of our kids in different ways.
It's a learning disability that affects the cognitive functions of the brain.
A lot of people have the misconception that it's a disability, and it's really not.
I look at it as like a special gift.
When one person thinks differently from another.
It's an opportunity for everyone to learn to understand someone that's a little different than them.
Autism is the ability to educate.
They're given so much talent in different areas.
To me, autism means a chance to be with and be around people you really care about. Autism is beautiful.
It's a way of seeing the world differently.
It's always unique, totally intelligent, and sometimes mysterious.
Happiness that comes out of my son's hard work.
Is a movement.
Unpredictable.
Abstract.
Awesome.
Love.
The field I want to work in.
Laughter. Fun. Joy.
Autism is beautiful to me.
I want you to remember these three words. There is hope.
Being part of this community is really important to a mom with a son like Jackson, because it really does take a village, and you need so much support, you know, to help bring out all of the amazing qualities and skills and talents that our children have. So I'm just very grateful to everybody who was a part of this.
I think it helps with all sorts of that self-esteem, social skills. They seem to communicate a little bit with each other, and they had a lot of friends. The helpers were phenomenal. And I think the social skills for sure, because they, you know, they worked together and they did a couple of group things across the floor and they sang songs together. And I yeah, for sure, I think it's a really huge deal, a great program.
What programs like this show is the person is in front of what we call today a disorder. I think what we're finding is that these sorts of brain challenges that make people unique can actually be gifts in ways we haven't discovered in the rest of society to bring them out. So when you see a program like this and you see the kids dancing, having fun, and making up jokes, making up the story, I was here when they did that. That was so amazing to watch, because they were all focused, they were all present, and they were all laughing, they were all getting into the creation of this story. And that to me sort of broke the barrier to say, well, first we're dealing with people, and then we're dealing with the challenges.
There are many beautiful things about autism, many, many beautiful, wonderful, gorgeous things about autism. But the very stark reality is that it's going to put some massive hurdles in front of the development of your child. And that is something that is not beautiful.
Welcome back to Autism Live. We were going to hit one more question. I apologize that we didn't get to more questions, but I love this question that came in on the live feature. Any tips for using ABA during the IEP? If reinforcing, if what we're trying to do is reinforce certain behaviors, how? Because more and more parents are starting to go, wait a second, so I'm doing this with my child and it works. So how do I expand this into other things?
I love it.
Right?
I think it's fantastic, because yeah. ABA is all about life. No question. I mean, I always, when I give lectures, I always tell parents, after you get really good at ABA, you can use it on your spouse. Like, and let then, me tell you, it's amazing.
And then use it on your IEP team.
And
like,
your
woo-hoo.
Boss and everybody in
exactly.
the world.
Exactly.
So IEP team, absolutely. I mean, there are certain things you want your team to do, and there are certain things you don't want them to do. You know, it's amazing. If you get into the depth of this, it is pretty amazing. You know, we might go a little over, but I want to talk about this, because there was this research that was done where it was a social psychology study, and the students in a lecture hall at a university were instructed to, whenever the professor said something, they would all kind of look away, right? Just for a minute. And it was very, very clear that it showed, just by looking away, they altered the behavior of that individual, of the professor. And yeah. the professor no longer, in all the future lectures, used that particular statement or language or whatever it was. It is incredibly effective with body language. In other words, if you're at an IEP and they tell you something you don't want to hear, like, just giving your disapproval is a punisher. And then when they do give you, and you can prompt them to give you the stuff that you want them to give you.